What's up, you guys? Aditi, welcome back to our channel. I know I have not done cognitive related video in a long time, like I think it's been a year, especially when it comes to memory wale videos. I know that I studied memory in the first year and I'm in the final year right now, the third year, so I just totally forgot about this. But I'm back again asking a very important, a very logical question, you know, like how reliable our memories are. Let's begin. How many times have you said this or you have heard that, you know what, I have a great memory, whatever I remember, it's accurate, it's perfect, nobody gets to question it, blah blah blah. It's not true. Our memories do change, and the changes that take place in our memory could be because of how the memories were formed or how they are being retrieved. So when we retrieve information from our long-term memory, either the information, like some pieces of the information of the whole incident, for example, some things get lost, or things do get changed or altered. And the more time passes, so like the longer, not the longer, but jitni purani, jitni old memory ho, more inaccuracies kind of creep in. So in the early 20th century or something, there was this theorist, Sir Frederick, I'm gonna read the name because I keep forgetting this name, Sir Frederick Bartlett. In 1932, he saw the process of memory as similar to recreating or like saying the story out loud instead of reading the story that has already been written. Because that's what we keep saying, that like the memories that I have, I can instantly replay them, like I can retrieve them in such a way that, you know, you start seeing the whole picture like a movie in front of your eyes and all of that. So it's not like reading a story that's already been written, but it's more like you remember the story, you know the story, and now you are just reiterating it. So what Frederick Bartlett Sir was saying is that when we are trying to retrieve any memory, he considered that as a problem solving situation. So when we are trying to remember some bits and pieces of a past event, that is the problem. For doing that, we are using current knowledge and inferring from evidence, which is the solution. There was this person, a woman, Elizabeth Loftus. She and other researchers did a lot of research on this one thing, and they call it constructive processing of memories. So basically what they said was that memories are literally built, or they are reconstructed from the information that is already stored during encoding. So each time you are retrieving memory from your long-term memory, that memory kind of, you know, gets altered or changes due to some new information that you already know, or it excludes some details due to new stuff that you know. So for example, an incident has happened in your life, and after a few months or after a few years, when you reiterate that event, when you pull it out of your memory, you do add your emotions, your thoughts, your views, your opinions about that event as well, and that kind of restructures that memory a little bit, or maybe a lot. Another example of constructive processing is hindsight bias. If you know what hindsight bias is, hindsight bias is where the event has already happened, and then you are like, you know what, I knew that this would happen. So like you say that retrospectively, this is what you thought and this is exactly what happened. So I'll give you the proper definition of hindsight bias. It's a tendency of people to falsely believe that they would have accurately predicted an outcome without having been told about it in advance. That is hindsight bias. So constructive processing of memory retrieval is one aspect of why memories are not very reliable. Another is memory retrieval problems. Like retrieving memory itself is a huge task, and that's when things can happen. So first point in memory retrieval problems is misinformation effect. So I don't know if people do this in India or not, because I never practiced in criminal law or in criminal courts, but this is the textbook that I use is Pearson, which is an American textbook, so I'm just going to talk about what they said in the book, because that's how I can explain this point actually. So what they said in the textbook is that policemen, maybe there was an accident or something, so they will not, or a crime or whatever, so you have eyewitnesses, and they normally try that two eyewitnesses don't talk to each other, because maybe one eyewitness saw it from the top and the other witness saw it from the side or whatever. They may have different pieces of information, or they did see it from one view, but all of that happened did not register, because even if you are giving focus to a particular thing, I will explain about attention and consciousness and everything, which is a part of cognition as well. I make videos, separate videos on it. But even if two people are seeing the same thing, I spoke this in Gestalt, I think. I'll put the video up there. Even if two people are looking at the same thing, they interpret it differently, they focus on different things, they pay attention to different things, and as a reason why different things are registered in our brain or in a long-term memory. So if two eyewitnesses talk to each other about that incident, they will share information, and then, for example, if I did not know that information A happened, I will reconstruct, obviously subconsciously, my memory of that incident and say it, like maybe to the court or to the police or whatever, that, oh no, you know what, that A thing did happen. I know, I saw it, although you did not even pay attention to it. So to avoid this misinformation effect, this thing is done where the two witnesses are not supposed to speak to each other. Now you know, right, why I said that maybe memories are not really reliable, they're not really accurate, because we did create a false memory about that incident, about that one piece, that information A. So Elizabeth Loftus, the same woman, she conducted a study on this misinformation effect, where she tried to create these false memories in people, or, you know, tried to like doubt their own memory in a way. So she had two groups. Both the groups were shown a slideshow. Okay, the slideshow of a traffic accident where there was a stop sign. Okay, now one of these two groups were given a written summary where they said that it was a yield sign. Now this is a misinformation. It was actually a stop sign, but they were told in the written summary it was a yield sign. So though that group that was given this misinformation, they kind of less accurate about their own memory about, oh, did I see a stop sign or was it a yield sign? Whereas those people who were not given the written summary or the misleading information, they were very strong and they were very accurate about their memory. Another memory problem is false memories, which is kind of like misinformation effect but a little different. So false memories, or false memory syndrome actually, refers to the creation of inaccurate or false memories through the suggestion of others, often while the person is under hypnosis. So research has shown that so we kind of know that when people are under hypnosis, the therapist who is conducting the hypnosis, they kind of suggest a few things to find out more about a person's past or childhood trauma or whatever the reason is that they are under hypnosis. So when they are suggesting these things, the patient may actually start believing these things, and they may actually just create these false memories in their head and actually also start believing these memories as real memories. So to find out whether real memories are so to find out that if these false memories are created like the real memories, of course study research is conducted, and they found that the false memories are formed in the brain in the same way as the real memories are. they looked at the individual's brain activity using fMRI scans, and so they did this when the individuals were looking at real visual images. And later, when they were asked by the researcher, you know, which image that they had actually seen or which they had imagined, they could not later distinguish between these two. So we come back to the question that can we even trust our memories? Then I think the answer could be yes. It's a little complicated because there is evidence that suggests that false memories cannot be created for any kind of memory content. Okay, so you can only create false memories about those events that could be plausible. What I mean by plausible is that something that could happen in your life. It's something extraordinary, like you met the Prime Minister, or something that is just impossible. You cannot create a false memory for that. So to explain this, let me tell you a study that was conducted by Pestek. I think it's Kathy Pestek and Hodge. Yeah, it's Hodge. They conducted this study in 1999. And in the study, they kind of gave five sentences or five events to children, out of which three were sach mein unke saath hua tha. Two of them were like false memories. Now, out of these two false memories, one of them was plausible, you know, like maybe they got lost in a mall or something like that. And third was like very bizarre, like maybe they got a rectal enema, or I don't know, maybe they got kidney stones. I don't know, like something very bizarre, maybe children would probably not have. What they found was that the plausible false memories, they were more likely to be remembered as, oh yeah, that just did happen with me, although it hasn't actually happened. Whereas the bizarre ones, like the impossible, implausible false memories, they did not believe it, like, nee, this did not happen with me. And that is it for today's video. I hope you learned about memory and whether memory is reliable, you can trust it or not, or what. Like, share and subscribe to this. Like, share this video and subscribe to this channel for more psychology content. I'll see you next Friday, hopefully with another psychology video.